Welcome guys, myself is Mayuresh Katavkar. Today's webinar is on the VADR identification with some tips and tricks. VADRs are with some confusing sandpapers and plovers around us. Basically, we won't discuss about the migration or the ecology. This is more basically towards the identification of the VADRs from the help of some combination of features like shape, washer, feeding, behavior, flights. With this webinar, I am considering the most of you are aware of the term VADR. Those don't know, the VADR are the group of birds commonly found along the coastal habitat, shorelines, lake, mud flats. Those VADRs, in the order to search for food, the food like worms, small crustaceans, insects, on the mud or on sand. The few species like sandpipers, plovers, godwits, chinch are called VADRs. We mainly speak on, we'll focus on the winter plumage, which occurs from November to February, but also talks on a juvenile plumage birds, which comes early up to September to October, then the summer birds, as well as some summer birds which show partial breeding plumage. We wait up to May in a field, we might get a full breeding plumage birds on a field. This is the second slide, what to look for when the bird is perched. You can see my cursor? I'm considering you can hear me and see the cursor.
Yes.
When the bird is perched like this or ground, look for the big shape. Then the wing projections, then the vent, tarsals, leg, beak, beak color. Again, this will be a focus on a combination of features, not only a single feature to pinpoint or to identify the single species. Okay, in a flight, here, look for the rump, then the wing and the tail patterns. Each bird has a different flight signature. Then the toe projections from the tail. These are the toe projection, and this is the tail. Then the bleeds, auxiliaries, or simple terms, armpits, which can be very important in identification, like a grey plover, or it's also called a black-bellied plover. The armpits in grey plover are very unique, and black armpits can be found in the most of the plumage of this. It's unique in the grey plover plumage. Then plumage, a molting, as the bird molts. We are giving a representation of a sanderling here. The juvenile molt, which starts from July to Jan. You can see a buffy tinge all over the body, up to a side of a chest here. Then the adult winter bird, it occurs from October to February, where we get to see a very plain pale birds, with mostly unmarked, very clean birds. Then comes the adult birds. They occurs from Feb to May or Feb to April, which are more patterned. As they start molting into breeding plumage, they become more scaly, eventually become more darker, more rufous and reddish on the upper parts. This is a flight. Each bird has a unique wing pattern. As I told you earlier, tail to toe ratio, wing bars. This is a combination of the structure of a flight. It's also called a flight signature. You can notice a down curve beak in some large waders like Wimbrand and Curlews. Some wing bars on the back, like here in a sanderling, in black tail godwit. Even some flight pattern, which are very unique to birds, like a common sandpiper, has a unique flight pattern. They fly very low to the ground, low to water surface, and turns before it's land. Sometimes a toe projection, like in between black tail godwit and bar tail godwit, they will show a bar tail godwit will show a prominent toe projection compared to bar tail godwit. this is a two group. Basically, I made two groups. Waders comes in all the different shape and sizes. Some are large as a girl, small like sparrow. So our first approach will be categorize them into two basic groups. One is a plover. Another will be a sandpipers, godwits, and curlews. Best way to identify plover is from their upright stance like lapwing. Lapwing also a plover. With a small and stubby beak, shorter neck, sometimes tapping on a surface. Plover tap on a surface to disturb worms and small crustaceans. Whereas in sandpipers, they will show more variety of beak color, shape, small, thin, long, down curve, with a different legs, different height, and a diverse feeding behavior. This is the first group. The plovers. Plovers are, as we discussed earlier, comes in a various plumage size. Some looks gold, gray, some stockier, with some distinct colored and the face masks with unique summer plumage. Then a sandpipers. We have a set of different kind of sandpipers here. They come from small to large size birds of mud flats, near water sites, some regulating winters. Handful are residents, also some are rare. We again group them in three parts: tiny as a stint, dunlin, broadbill, curlew sandpipers. Then second will be a common red shank, knots, ruff, green shank, and mass sandpipers. Then there'll be a large group of waders, godwits, and curlew. And this group we are having two godwits, so that is blacktail and godwit. And last will be a whimbrel and Eurasian curlew with the one rare varied for Bombay region, long-billed dovitcher. We start from the little stint, one of the smallest sandpipers peeps for our area. It's regularly wintering. A sandpiper in our region occurs in the most of its plumage from juvenile. This is a juvenile plumage from the non-breeding winter bird up to a summer bird like this. These are mostly found in mud flats, coastal lagoons, creeks, marshes, paddy field, and small lakes. It's a small wide-bellied sandpiper with a distinct upper cilium, which is prominent in juveniles, very much prominent in juveniles. You can easily see a supercilium here. Also, sometimes can look like it has a split supercilium because of the streak head. It has a streaks on his head, streak. That's why it looks like a split supercilium. Juvenile stint has a pattern or streak upper body with the rufous fringes. These are the rufous fringes. Fringes means the edge of a feather. And some of the feathers have a white tips on those. You can see it here. So if you're watching a little juvenile stint from above, it might look a V-shape like this. Might be alphabet from above. Okay. Prominently with the black legs, but looks brownish again in the darker background. Light condition differs if you're watching a bird regularly. So sometimes it is very good point to separate it from the sanderling, because sanderling has a very dark jet black leg color. Also shows shorter wingtips. Wingtip is much more going further than the tail. Then the adult winter birds. These are the adult winter birds. Is more towards a pale gray on forehead and brownish gray upper parts with a lace mark, except throat and underparts, which are very much white. Sometimes shows a broad gray brown on a side of a chest here. Consider this as a very good indication for the identification of little stint, sometimes very useful in a field compared to a sanderlings. Sanderling is a much bigger bird, but and profile-wise, ease-wise, both look same from the certain distance. In summer, area surrounding the eyes and upper parts from the forehead, it become rufous to rusty. Bird become more darker, more rufous, but belly remains the white. In even in the flight, a little stint will show you a gray outer tail feather, which is a few times very important compared to a taming shit, because taming shit will show you white feathers, and in the little shit they have a gray outer tail feather. I think I said white tail feathers instead of that. It's a white tail feather, a gray tail feathers here, and the taming has a white tail feather. And the typical feeding action of little shrimp are like a sieving machine. They feeding rapidly. That can also eliminate other species from like a sanderling. They run on a shore at the tide recede. So that's a key features. These and sometimes these also. But it's again a combination of features you have to look after. Next, the taming stint. Again, a winter visitor. Take a stint on a board. People's freshwater marshes, coastal lagoons, tidal creeks, paddy fields, lake. Much stockier than the little stint. Gray brown hair with incomplete trace of supercilium. Very patchy supercilium. You can't see it actually. Means it's broken or the patchy kind of stuff. Then the not a significant change in the winter to summer plumage. Few birds show a lot of differences in the winter to breeding plumage, but early this taming stint has a very minute change. It's only adapted to a rufous marking above, but summer the taming stint comes with the irregular dark marking on the upper part, and most importantly, the complete breech band or chest band in all plumages look like very much dark in low light, and compared to a little stint, it's very much confined to a sides. Even a bird will show you a yellow leg. It's darker in little, a straight darker brown gray beak with a yellow base. If you see closer, there is a yellow base at the base of the bill. Again in flight, white outer tail feathers compared to a gray feathers in little stint. Then comes the sanderling. Again a wintering wader. As Latin name suggests, Calidris alba means white. Sanderling appears more clean white than other same size waders found in shore, sandy beaches, creeks, inland, lakes. Sanderling is larger than the little stint, but sometimes juvenile birds can be look like a little stint with the plumage, but you can make out juvenile birds look pattern like, looks very much pattern on the back, white and with the buff wash. No trace of a rufous here. Versus juvenile stints will show fringes of a rufous color here. Winter birds are very much gray and silvery above with the white forehead and shining white blue. Only sandpiper with the absence of hind toe. It means a sanderling is the only sandpiper having a three toes. Okay, it's called a tridactyl foot, but again, it's very difficult to observe in a field unless a bird is on a dry sand or you are watching closely. Combination of dark black legs, black bill with the black wing tips are prominent against the pale bird. Has a black lesser wing cover which are more visible in flight. Also, they seats. The seats a black patch at the bend at the wing, but it is concealed with the breech feather. There is a black color bend here on the wings, but it is not visible because of the breech feathers. From the March April, sanderling molds into a breeding plumage. From head to breech become more rufous as compared to a upper part. Can be confused with the little stint, but it has a larger appearance with the rufous center for dark towards. Means if you see it here, the feathers has a rufous center, okay, and a black outer with a white fringes. Versus in the little, they have a black centers. Okay. Mostly feeds on a group, runs quickly along the edge of a surf. In flight, broad white wing bar on a dark wing, which is much broader than the little shin and the stemming shin. Now a comparison of the three species we just saw. As a head pattern, stemming shin has a uniform brown head compared to tuol. Then the little shin has a whitish brown streak head. Sanderling has a very white forehead with a gray streak on. In the beak, it's straight, darker gray with a yellow base. In little, it's darker, straight and fine tip. In sanderling, it's jet black and straight. Breech band, in a temming shin, it's brown and complete. In little shin, it's marked brownish, cold gray with the white fringes. Upper parts in sanderling are very rich in silvery gray. This criteria is very much difficult to observe, sometimes covered with the mud. So legs are yellowish in temming shin, darker brown and black in little shin, and sanderling a jet black and lacking a hind toe. Flight features. As we discussed earlier, gray outer tail with small wing bar. In little shin, white outer tail with small wing bar. And sanderling, center line on a tail and a dark wing with a broad wing bar. Broadest among these two, temming shin and the little shin. We end the small peeps or sandpipers here, move to a broadbill sandpiper or the it's again a wintering bird, restricted to a tidal coast, mud flats, sometimes in saline lagoons, smallest among the dunlins and curlew. Although these three have a downcurved beak, but this is one of the smallest among these three. A small wader with a streak breast and upper parts. Juvenile birds are more streak. These are the juvenile birds. These are more streak and pattern. It's a short-legged bird, relatively larger head with a split supercilium. This is called a split supercilium, which starts from the forehead and fork in between. So this term called as a split supercilium is very much prominent in summer bird and the juvenile bird with a dark eye strip. Yeah, and beak is broad as the name suggests. Is a down curve with a kink or a bend near the end. If you look the beak carefully, it's going straight and bending at the last, not evenly curved like a curlew sandpiper has. In the winter, this becomes more paler, grayer in appearance. But in summer, broad streaks on the neck and breast contrasting with the wide belly. Yeah, it's very patchy. Then a rufous fringes to the mantle, yeah, and the scapular feathers are white. But overall shape of the bird is a bit unique to give away its identification. In the dunlin, the second bird which shows the downcurved beak. My speed is okay, Prathamesh?
Prathamesh? Yes, sir. Maybe slightly, थोड़ा सा स्लो अजून घेऊ शकतो.
ओके.
लेट
मी कन्फेस दिस.
I will.
बेसिकली I'm not used to this. I'm more comfortable in the field. My words may sound like they are scripted, but I have to think of the words and then speak to you. That's the main thing.
You can even you can use Hindi English Marathi combination also.
No problem.
So however, we'll take it.
Now
yeah, dunlin. Perfect. Continue.
Dunlin regularly winters in our shores, creeks, mud flats, backwaters of dams. Basically, a well proportionate bird. Some early arrival birds means dunlin show some unique husky streaks on the flanks, and juvenile dunlins, these early arrivals, can show longer bill, can be some confusing with the curlew sandpiper. But in curlew sandpiper, it is the head is more strict and the flanks are more clear. They are not marked like Dunlin. So that's the main giveaway for the ID. Even a female curlew sandpiper has a longer bill. Sometimes winters can be confusing. But in Dunlin, the hair is much paler, and there is a not streaks on the hair. So that's the main thing to look after. In summer, in winter, the bird with the darker gray brown above and the white below, with a brownish wash on the chest. It's more streaked on the curlew sandpiper. And this fellow will show a long down curved bill. If you see it carefully, at the tip, there is a little bulge. Means there is a tip, like tip has a water drop. It's also called a droop drip. And sometimes also look like bulging at the end. In this winter plumage, there are some interesting supercilium, but you can easily eliminate curlew sandpiper because of the beak and the pale head. Okay, Dunlin has a much shorter leg than the curlew, so that's the main giveaway sometimes in a field. Dunlin has a much in a breeding. Dunlin has a much shorter legs. I am not getting a screen here. Okay. In breeding, black belly, there is a patch on the belly, is more prominent affirmative clue in identification. Interestingly, a breeding male has a whitish hind neck here, and a female will show you a browner neck here. Then the curlew sandpiper. Again, one of the regular wintering wader, mainly towards the coastal mud flats, shore, salt pans, and sometime in a freshwater lake. Also in backwaters like Big One, comparatively a long leg and long neck bird than the Dunlin with a prominent supercilium, with a long, eventually decurved fine tip bill with a no bulging. Like this, juvenile birds show strong supercilium, streak head with a wash on a chest, scaly upper parts versus a Dunlin will show a dark marking on a flank here, rather diffuse streak and short eye strip here compared to a juvenile curlew. The flanks are missing in juvenile curlew. In Dunlin's, they are marked. In winter, curlew sandpiper hair is also in winter, curlew sandpiper hair is thick but shows a distinct supercilium. Versus in the Dunlin, will show you a paler head. In winters, upper parts are much gray and white below. We will compare the three species. In this, the downcurved beak sandpipers in winter, the broadbill sandpiper, Dunlin, and curlew sandpiper. Beak, basically, in broadbill sandpiper, the beak is broad at the base and king at the tip. In a Dunlin, droop tip and long. See the bulging at the end versus in curlew sandpiper, long and smoothly curved with fine tip. Then the head. Head is a split supercilium. In Dunlin is a pale and brown. It's split supercilium. It's plain and brown. And in curlew sandpiper, it's prominent supercilium. You can see a supercilium here in winter plumage of curlew sandpiper, which is very patchy or absent in Dunlin. Then the back upper parts, a dark shaft and streaks. इन डनलिन शॉर्ट सॉरी पेल एंड ब्राउन एंड इन कर्ली सैंड पेपर इट्स पेल एंड ग्रे. लेग्स इन ब्रॉडबिल सैंड पेपर आर शॉर्ट एंड हैज अ ग्रीनिश ट्रेस. इन डनलिन दोज आर शॉर्ट एंड ग्रे. इन कर्ली सैंड पेपर क्वाइट लॉन्गर दैन डनलिन इन ब्लैक. In flight features, sometimes very difficult to observe. They are flying at long distance. Dark rump on a tail. In broadbill sandpiper, Dunlin has a dark rump with a dark center line on the tail, and curlew sandpiper has a white rump on a dark tail. Now, ruddy tone stones and terek sandpiper. The terek sandpiper, I always fascinated by its beak shape. Only handful of waders have this kind of upcurved beak. The mainly found at seashore and coastal mudflats. Comes with a long upcurved beak with orange legs. If you look closer, there is a yellowish orange base at the bill. The terek sandpiper have a peculiar action of running. They get lean forward and run for food. In a flight, the terek sandpiper will show a white trailing edge and the gray rump. See, this is a unique bird, so you can make it easily in a field. So I am not giving a larger briefing on this as well as on a tungsten, because they have a unique shape, unique characteristic on their plumages. Then the tungsten are mostly found on shore and coastal mudflats and creeks. Stocky. Much rounded bird with a unique wedge bill to turn or the roll over the pebble or the shells. Always shows the bold dark ridge band with the orange leg in any plumage. You see this bird in any plumage has always orange legs and the black ridge band. So breeding and non-breeding bird, the same retention. In beginning of the summer, they molt into bright orange brown on upper body, means wing covers and the scapulars become orange brown, contrasting with the underparts, white belly with a dark breast band. In flight also, tungstone will show you boldly marked upper parts with a black on the neck. In the next bird, now a medium-sized bird, waders, common sandpiper. One of the most commonest sandpiper for our region, it's breeds in northwest Himalaya, found most of the habitat of from forest water bodies, freshwater lakes, salt pans to shore to mudflat. You can call habitat-wise the jack of all birds. First thing we'll notice that this is a very short neck bird which regularly bob its rear body. They do they move their rear body up and down after landing or some action like catching a prey or like that. Show barrings on wings and comparatively longer tail in this segment like wood sandpiper, mast sandpiper, green sandpiper. Between those, they have a longer tail. Noticeable the white patch here on a gap on the side of the breast. It's very distinctive to this common sandpiper. Again, distinct supercilium, paler after the eye. Sometimes upper parts look golden in certain light conditions. And as I told you earlier, has a distinctive flight pattern consists of a rapid and shallow wing beats combined with the short glides, often fly close to a ground or surface of water. In flight, very much visible wing bar, the dark tail, of course, center of a rump. Whereas in mast sandpiper, green sandpiper, and wood sandpiper will show white on a rump, which is absent in common sandpiper. Can be used as an identification point to eliminate other waders. Okay. Then the green sandpiper. Again, a winter visitor wader, restricted to inland waters, but can be appear in the creeks, salt pans. Basically, a two-tone birds, dark above, light below. if flush from the small pools or tiny ditches, they make a distinctive call and fly away. Comparatively rather long beak, the white-sticked supercilium, which is absent beyond the eye, has a clear-cut border on its chest. And while feeding, you can notice a broad bars on the tail. You can't see here, but if you're watching a bird on the field, if he's feeding, you can able to see the white broad bars on the tail. Breeding birds are more finely speckled, will be marked with the streakings on the neck. Yeah, no wing bars in flight, but rather dark and plain upper wing. In a flight, look much darker compared to other waders. You can see here one of the darkest waders in the flight in this segment. Then a wood sandpiper. Again, a winter visitor, very common bird from our region, regularly found in the, both the habitat, means saltwater and freshwater. Somehow dull and more patterned bird than the green sandpiper, with a prominent supercilium which goes behind the eyes, shows a diffuse pattern on a chest here, whereas in green sandpiper, it has a clear-cut border. In summer, it becomes heavily checkered, heavily marked, but it moves to a less of a brown and more towards the white. Juvenile birds are more brown on upper part. Visible narrow marks, dark marks on a tail. Then in flight, no wing bars, but prominent brown white spots on upper wing. Barrings on a tail are visible, and the projection of the toes are more prominent than the green sandpiper. We'll compare the three birds we just gone through, a common sandpiper, a wood sandpiper, and the green sandpiper. Just a minute. The head of a common sandpiper, it's much brown with a supercilium painting behind the eye. Wood sandpiper has a prominent supercilium. In green sandpiper, dark, the head is dark, grey, greenish, and supercilium is restricted to the front of the eye. The upper parts, they are darker yellow-brown. Wood sandpiper, brown, palish with white spots. In green sandpiper, darkish among all with finely speckled. Underparts has a wide gap here on the side of a breast and the wide belly. In wood sandpiper, diffuse pattern on a breast or chest with whitish belly. And in green sandpiper, clear cut border on chest with a whitish belly. Yeah. Okay. Then a marsh sandpiper. Regular wintering wader found near the inland marshes, ponds, mudflats. Much more elegant sandpiper in this group. In winter, it has a grayish upper part with a gray cap and white below. The beak is straight, thin, and dark with a very long legs. Can see a delicate replica of common green shank, but can make out from the shape and structure of a beak. Green shank has a very strong upturned beak. Shows a very fine band on the tail, which are prominent in flight. Wide edges on a black, with a no wing bar. But in summer, the neck is much marked and spot on a chest and the black pattern above. The black checkers above is blotching is there in the summer as the bird molt into a summer plumage. Then the common green shank. Again, a wintering wader, long grayish wader, found singly or in small numbers, mainly near coastal lagoons, creeks, open mud flats, quite bigger than the red shank. Juvenile birds are dark, streaked, upper parts with a whitish border, means a fringes to a feather. Wintering green shanks show pale gray upper parts with a fine scaly pattern. whitish belly and sometimes look paler with streaks or streaks on it. Beak is long, stout, and slightly upturned with a strong yellowish green legs. Then the adult summer birds are much thick and spotted than the winter birds. Also, common green shank has a typical feeding practice. They suddenly dash for the food. If you watch them regularly or carefully, they will suddenly dash or run for the food, leaning down. In the field, can easily differentiate from the mast sandpiper by its robust bill and strong legs. In flight, tail shows a fine noticeable barring and a dark wing and a white wedge. This is white wedge, the white side on the back, on the lower back also. Okay, then the comparison between the mast sandpiper and the green sandpiper in winters. The head in mast sandpiper, it shows a neat cap. Whether in common green shank, rather streak and grayish. Okay, bill is long, pointing and straight. In common green shank is long, stout and slightly upturned. Again, the legs long, elegant and yellowish. In common green shank, this is long, strong and gray green. Now a common green shank. Common red shank. Common red shank breeds in northwest Himalaya, winters across India. Typical poolside wader found in estuaries, salt marsh, shore, and creek. Common red shank is a very active and noisy bird. Bob their heads in a field frequently. Red legs and red bill are prominent points towards its identification, but sometimes, like the juvenile bird, will show a dark yellow legs, so can be confused with some rubs and wood sandpipers. But they also show a grayish upper part, which are absent in plain grayish upper parts, which are absent in wood sandpiper. Common red shank has a straight and stout bill, restricted supercilium, again up to the front of the eye. Sometimes diffuse in adults. Here is adult bird. The supercilium is very much diffuse. Mainly brownish above and sticks on the breast and flanks. Winter birds, like here, are much plainer, grayer. As the bird molds into a breeding plumage, it becomes darker. And streak continues all over the upper part and under part. In flight, white hind wing bar. This is very important to see because similar looking waders like spotted red shank missing this thing, they have a uniform wing. In flight, the hind wing bar is there and also wedge on the back. In a spotted red shank. Again, a winter visitor commonly seen in estuaries, salt pans, fish waters, rarely seen in sandy shores because they spotted red shank wade deeply than the common. They are found in bit deeper water than the common red shank. They run, they dart, they up and they also swim. In non-breeding plumage, very similar looking wader to a common red shank. But more slim build, long leg, and deeply bodied. Red legs are similar to a common red shank, but the beak is more long, tapering fine with a bend near the end. Although it's red, but the only lower mandible is red in spotted red shank, whereas in common red shank, both the mandibles are red up to certain extent. Distinct supercilium. Whitish in front of the eye are more prominent in juveniles. Wintering birds are much pale grey above and whitish on underparts. in breeding birds has its own glory. You can see there, head and underparts molt into a jet black with a white speckling underparts, white speckling on upper parts. White eye ring is very much prominent. Even the leg becomes darker. Compared to a breeding common red shank, the adult breeding spotted red shank differs a lot. In a flight, no prominent wing bar, but has a white on lower back and also a longer toe projection than the common red shank. Again, a comparison between these two red shanks, common red shank and spotted red shank. Supercilium of a common red shank is a faint, patchy. In a spotted red shank, it's a prominent, painting beyond the eyes. The beak in common red shank is a long, straight, red in the both the mandibles. In a spotted red shank, it's much longer bill, tip at the end, and red is restricted to a lower mandible. In the common red shank, of course, long and red, but in spotted are much longer and red. Now a great note. A winter visitor confined to a coast, regular but in small number, always found in a small group feeding along the shoreline. Long and heavier bill. Note the bill is very much long and heavier with a small head. Juvenile great knots here will show much marked breast and upper part, whereas in adult winter birds will show more spotted on a chest and pale gray. Adult summer great knots are heavily spotted on a chest with rusty back patches. These are the most silent waders, not very vocal as other waders are. Also in flight, there is no specific wing bar, but well-marked wings and a gray tail with contrasting rump. Now a ruff. Again, a regular wintering medium-sized wader found near marshes, salt lakes, estuaries, creeks, fields. Interestingly, almost 5 cm difference in the male and female, so become very confusing species. Male are bigger than females, long leg, long neck. Female are much smaller than red shank, shorter bill. Overall, ruff look bit disproportionate because of the longer neck and much rounded body. Juvenile ruffs are, this is the juvenile ruff, are buff, dark, blunt wing with a yellowish tawny leg. Very much clean buff breast, no markings on the breast, and the back is scaly with the creamy fringes, means borders of back, feathers on the back are has like creamy outer lines. Feathers are border with the creamy cream color above fringes. Then see the tarsals are unbarred compared to adult birds. Okay. Then the first winter bird. A male have a pale base to a bill with white eye ring. In the adult winter, ruffs are gray brown. Short build with a white belly and legs are dull yellow. In between both the sexes, male has a whiter face. While long distance birds can easily confuse with the red shank, knots, and wood sandpipers with such kind of plumages. This is basically a pre-breeding and post-breeding slide. But we'll discuss about the flight first. in a flight, it has a small white wing bar and the white on a side of a rump here. So it's look like V on a rump on a tail. Okay. It's unique to this bird. Again, a pre-breeding bird is difficult to, but it's difficult to get breeding ruffs to witness their charm. But sometimes the early arrival of ruffs in month of July and August, we sustain some of their plumage legacy like this. So we can observe these birds in August to September. And these are breeding birds. In full breeding, the male will have a puffy collar. That's the name ruff comes. It means the collar was worn in Europe as a part of a wardrobe in between 16th and 17th century. That's why the name arrived, ruff. Then next slide is the look like of ruffs. Sometimes long distance ruffs are very confusing. If you are watching the bird from the long distance, you only able to see upper parts, so can be confusing. If you are watching only red leg birds from the distance, can be significant as a common red shank. If you are getting this plumage from the long distance, certainly things like you think as a wood sandpiper. That's why ruff are much confusing because of their plumages. Next, the large wader, a black tail godwit, a large long leg and long bill wader, mainly winters in our estuaries, creeks, salt pans, coastal mud flats, lagoon, also in inland marshes. Juvenile black tail are much darker, but those are rarely seen because when they occur, they are actually molting into a wet winter plumage here. So this plumage is oftenly seen, not regularly seen. In adult winter, black tail godwits are pale gray from neck to head and up to a chest with a whitish belly. Long leg, it has a longer leg than the black tail godwit. While feeding, you can see a prominent black on a tail, as the name suggests. Even the supercilium is restricted up to the front of the eye. And the beak is straight beak with reddish on a belly. From April onwards, the bird assumes their breeding plumage with much pard belly. Breeding of bar-tailed godwit is a plain, they have plain belly, but in black-tailed godwit, they have barred belly. So it's barred on the underparts, on the chest, on a breast, with orange rufous. Even the beak becomes orange. In flight, obviously a black tail, as the name suggests. Prominent wing bar, which is absent in bar-tailed godwit. The inner wings are more white and framed by black wingtips here and gradual toe projection. Okay, in the next, a bar-tailed godwit. Very similar looking bird to a black-tailed godwit. Winters in shore, tidal mudflats, uncommon in fresh water. Bar-tail is shorter than the black-tailed godwit because of its shorter tibia. Juvenile birds, again, are dark and pattern with a darker head, knit cap, but rarely seen in this plumage in our area. As any winter birds, adult winter birds comes with a much streaked and scaly upper parts, which are rather plain in black-tailed godwit. Bill is somewhat shorter than black-tailed godwit, more upcurved and fleshy pink at the base. The beak is more upturned and fleshy pink at the base. But it's sometimes difficult to observe because it can be covered with the mud. In April, they assume their breeding plumage. The underparts become a coppery red, extending a poor undertail, and more streak back, more pattern back. In a flight, it's lacking a wing bar, but noticeably barrings on a tail, and again a white triangle on a lower back. It's a godwit comparison. If you see it carefully, here is the black-tailed godwit, and here is a bar-tailed godwit, and the black-tailed godwit. You can see a toe projection here much further compared to bar-tailed godwit. Again, a wing bar, which is very much prominent in the black-tailed godwit, which is totally absent in a bar-tailed godwit. Also, a rump. Rump is restricted to certain area. Whereas in bar-tailed godwit, it carries up to a back. The white shape is carries up to a back. In again, in juvenile birds are rarely seen, but you can make out from the orange wash on a neck. Again, a winter bird. This is interesting. See the upturned beak compared to a straight beak of black-tailed godwit. It has a streak on the back as well as the wing. Whereas in black-tailed godwit has a plain back and the wings. In budding plumage, the bar tail will show you uniform underparts versus in bar tail, it has in bar tail has a uniform underparts, in the black tail has a barred underparts. Even the beak differs, it's darker and this is orange. Then the rare one, the long-billed dowitcher, one of Mumbaikar's wader, having winter appearance in Bandung pumping station from January 2017 to last recorded in January 2020. Long-billed dowitcher have a distinct shape like an oversized knot with a snipe-like bill. The legs are much longer and grim, but bill length varies with the sex and age. From the godwit, they show some yellowish-green legs, long straight and green beak. Dark green, actually. Also, a gentle slope on a forehead, if you are comparing with the godwit, with a white supercilium. Lace mark, brown gray upper part in winter, and pattern or checkered on a tail. In adult summer, dowitcher becomes more rufous with bell mark upper parts. In a flight, similar to godwit, but has a clear checkered rump and tail with a cigar shaped white on the back. Okay. Then Wimbrel, one of the large waders we have, comes with a long downcurved bill, winters mostly in a small flocks or in a single bird, on a coast, creeks, occasionally inland. The marsh, basically identification of Wimbrel is elimination of a curly features. So, bill or beak is one of that, but before taking as a granted, in the, both the species, the length of the bill are various to sex and ages. Means there are shorter bill male curlew can look like a Wimbrel. So, combination of a feature is a bigger factor. Mainly speaking, there is a pale but prominent crown stripe to show a stronger head pattern compared to a curlew. If you compare this and that, we'll come to know. Again, a dark eye strip here with a downcurved bill and usually more bent, less smoothly curved, means the curve is not evenly continuous compared to a Eurasian curlew. This is Eurasian curlew with evenly continuous, and this is going rather bending, not curving. In a flight, it's difficult to distinguish if they're flying far, but much darker, dark wings and wing bits are much thicker than a Eurasian curlew, and sometimes a darker tail. Both have a V on the lower back. So we move on a Eurasian curlew. A largest feeder in our region, winters in coast, shores, mud flats, dam, backwaters, inland water bodies, show very long and evenly downcurved beak with a rather plain head. Beak eye stripe, again a juvenile bird, we will show a shorter bill. Usually very noisy on the field as well as in flight. Feed slowly, probing their beak deep into mud. In flight, sometimes fly in a V formation like gulls. Dark outer wings in flight, plain inner wings. Again, a white V on the back, but in a flight, shows a much longer bill and has a heavy flight compared to a whimbrel. It's a comparison between those, mainly a bill. For whimbrel, bill is a very much shorter, is a shorter than curlews and distinctly kinked. In Eurasian, curlew is a much longer and evenly round curve. And the hair in the whimbrel is a pale brown with a dark eye stripe. In Eurasian curlew, is rather plain. Okay, we end our sandpiper segments here and we'll start on plovers. We start from the littering plover, a resident plover, reported from all over the country, adapted in most of the habitat throughout the India. Small, brown, white, black ring plover, standing and running on a freshwater margin and a mud flat. Adult bird can easily make out by their prominent yellow eye ring. These are the adult birds. You can easily make out the yellow eye ring. Difficulty comes when we get a juvenile bird and the immature bird along with the same plumage of the common ring plover and a kentish plover. But littering plover has a pale eye ring, sometimes visible. Sometimes is visible, but compared to common ring plover, which has a patchy remnants of a ring in a juvenile or immature plover. Okay, in a juvenile or immature birds, upper half of a head is a brownish. Okay, paler area over the eye. It's whiter throat and angular dark cheek markings. This is the angular cheek markings. If you're comparing this with the common ring plover, immature juvenile bird, it has a very much rounded marking here. Also, distinctive paler area above the eye, like a supercilium, which is absent in juvenile littering plover, but is very much prominent in a common ring plover. In a flight, lack of a wing bar it has no wing bar compared to a common ring plover, will show a prominent wing bar. Okay. Then the common ring plover. Actually, this bird is reported more and more throughout the country, the common ring plover. So I made this slide, add this slide. According to eBird, in 2017, there were 8 birds reported. In 2018, there were 10 birds reported. And 2019, there are 31 birds reported. So I think it's overlooked bird in most of the time. Again, the winter visitor mainly found in shore, mud flat, and the salt pans. Very similar looking to resident little ring plover, but much heavier, dumpier than little ring plover. In breeding, they will show you a double color beak, shorter tail, and longer, deeper belly than the ring plover, little ring plover, and the bright orange leg in the adults. But in a juvenile plumage or immature plumage, it have a duller legs, some kind of yellowish to oranges, and eyeing is reduced to a brownish side, or becomes very much patchy to a corner of the eyes. But shape sharp white forehead with white paint band over the eye is a basic feature to eliminate little ring plover. With a slender brush band, which is very broad in little ring plover. In the flight, in all plumages, they reveal a long white wing bar and wedge-shaped tail compared to a little ring plover. Now, a Kentish plover, a widespread winter visitor found near the shore, coast, mud flats, basically small and pale plover in immature or winter. Incomplete brush band, darker legs, noticeably small, chick-like bird, very small bird compared to other waders. It looked like a very small, chunky bird with rounded head, rounded body, thin but long and dark compared to both the ring plovers. Legs are set well back in the body. The position of the legs are set back in the body. Sometimes runs on a beach like sanderlings. Adult bird shows a rufous on a crown. Yeah. With the black on a forehead. And incomplete dark breast band. Immature birds, juvenile birds, are sometimes confusing with the lesser sand plover. But note the shape of the beak. And Kentish has a thin thin beak compared to a lesser sand plover, that is stout and short beak. Also white, also collar, which is absent in the lesser sand plover. The Kentish little ring, common ring plover shows a distinctive collar, white collar, which are absent in lesser sand plover and greater sand plover. In the flight, wing strips are like common ring plover, but square tail with white on the side up to a rump. Yeah, with a central black patch. Okay, then we go a comparison of these small plovers in their immature or juvenile plumage. The beak wise, in a Kentish plover, the beak is thin and darkish. In a little ring plover, beak is slim and pale at the base, sometimes not visible if it's covered in mud. In a small ring plover, the beak is small but stout and orange at the base. Forehead in the Kentish plover is a large white. In a little ring plover, forehead is a small white with confined in the mask, head mask. In the common ring plover, it has a large white patch or a mask in its helmet. The supercilium, front of the eye, is white, then again fading beyond the eye. In little ring plover, indistinct or the marginal, very patchy, which much browner. In common ring plover, is ongoing and prominent. The helmet means, I'm using some local terms with unscientific way, but it can easily understandable. The helmet is this part, head part. Kentish flower has a uniform brown patch, whereas in littering flower, the helmet or the point is going down towards the breast band. In commoning flower, it's rounded at the side. Is rounded but not going down. Okay. In the breast band, in Kentish flower, it's half and restricted, not going, continuing, not merging. In little ring flower, it's very much broad and continuous. And common ring flower, small, uniform, and getting continuous. The legs, these criteria again can be coated with the mud, very difficult to observe. But in Kentish, legs are dark, gray, grayish. In little ring, it's more greenish to pinkish gray. In common ring flower, those are yellow and orange. Okay. Now we move to a lesser sand flower. Breeds in North Himalaya, some part of Tibetan plateau. Winters in shoreline, mud flats, field, and coastal wetland. Separating from ring and Kentish flower, it's much long legged bird with the absence of a white collar. There is no white collar. In non-breeding from the gator sand flower, bill is stout but rather short. And the main part, the nail means this part, the little bulging on the beak at the end. If you're considering the whole bill, okay, the nail is less than half of the length of the beak. Means this is a full bill, the half will be here, is a nail is less than half of the beak. Okay, much darker legs compared to a greater sand flower. In breeding, black mask over the forehead with a white throat, deep orange rust on a breast, also on the sides up to a nape. Up to here, they have orange rust. Also in flight, toe projection are beyond the tail, but it's marginal. And a slightly slender wing bar can be seen in a flight. In greater sand flower, again a wintering wader found at coastal wetlands, beach, mud flats. In winter, looks similar to a lesser sand flower, but have a much heavier bill. And again, that nail formula, if you're watching a bird very carefully and closely, the nail is half of or more than a total length. Means this is a beak and the nail is more than half or half than the total bill length. Legs are usually green, long and strong than the lesser sand flowers. In breeding, again a rusty rufous head with a black mask, with a white forehead. Again a white throat, rusty orange at the nape. Again breast band with the orange and rusty goes up to a side of a chest, and occasionally rusty spots on the back. You can see sometimes, not usually, always rusty spots on the back compared to a lesser sand flower. Okay, then we compare these three flowers we just gone through: Kentish flower, lesser sand flower, and a greater sand flower. In their winter plumage, mainly a beak. In Kentish flower, it's a small, thin. In lesser sand flower, it's rather short but strong. And the greater sand flower is stout and strong. It's bulky compared to a lesser sand flower. In Kentish flower, collar is full white on the neck. In lesser sand flower is absent. Again, in greater sand flower is absent. Legs. In Kentish flower, they are gray-greenish. In lesser sand flower, they are dark grayish. And in greater sand flower, they are pale-greenish. Okay. Then the Pacific golden flower. Very handsome flower in our region. Winters, visitor mainly found in groups or small numbers near coast, coastal lagoons, wetland. It's very much small and slimmer plover than the gray or black-bellied plover. Winter or immature bird show the small and very thin bill compared to a gray plover. Again, if you're comparing with the gray plover, it has a very much long leg bird with a slim appearance. In winters, as a buffish was supercilium, golden yellow marking on upper part, long neck, much rounded but small head compared to a gray plover. In a summer, molting starts, golden plover shows a black, it starts from here, face, neck, to a breast and the belly, bordering with the white. Okay. And remaining upper part becomes coarsely patterned with a gold and white. In a flight, uniform golden upper part in wintering plumage, crepe wing in breeding plumage in a flight can be resemblance as in a low light can look like black bellied or a gray plover, but in a flight if you able to see auxiliaries or armpit, they are black, which are absent in Pacific golden plover. In the black-bellied plover, they have black armpits. Okay? In the black-bellied plover. The last plover on the table, again a winter visitor in our region, mainly towards the coast, sometimes in a sandy shore, tidal pools, adjoining mud flats, but sometimes also in the backwaters of a dam, like Jayakwadi, sometimes in Big Bend. Slightly larger than the golden plover with a shorter leg, heavy bill, stockier appearance. In winter, bird looks much colorless. Mottled dark gray upper parts with a pale buff, gray and whitish below. Looks dark in a dull light and pale in a dark sunlight. In summer, when they start molting, gray plover starts in a mottled black on a neck, chest, ear, shows a solid black belly with a white wing. Okay, sometimes early autumn birds arrives in our region, our coast. They are partially colored, looks eye catching. But it's very difficult to get in the monsoons. We are restricted to more in ODKF and this stuff. In flight, white wing tip are longer than golden plover. And with a white drum and unique black armpit. This is one of the unique feature of this plover. This only appears in the gray plover. Okay, this was the last slide. We cover around 28 species here. Thanks, guys. I'm thanking you.